What are we doing today?
Five words or less.
Out for a tag.
Bitch. Get started.
Hello, welcome back on my channel. If you're new here, hi, my name is Sissy, and I really want to get into book tags. And what a better way to achieve that than starting out by creating my very own. You do not need to be into vampires, and you do not need to be into Buffy to follow along with this book tag.
Spike, you've heard of me?
No.
I did try to phrase the prompts for this book tag in a way that they can be quite broadly answered. Bonus points if you can find a recommendation that the prompt was inspired by.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds fun.
Why did I choose the book tag based on Spike from Buffy the Vampire Slayer? If you've been on my channel for a while, you know that I like myself a good villain.
Is that right? I must have missed the memo.
And there's something in darkness that is just incredibly delicious.
Desperate, are you?
In my 20s, I had a huge crush on that fictional character. Since then, I've been always on the lookout for really cool book recommendations based on the character traits that this fictional character has, but I could never find any. I felt like I have to create a book tag to find this recommendation. Also, receiving a birthday message, James Marsters, to my 40th birthday completely got me back into that huge crush.
And this has got you, what? All nostalgic now, has it?
So I thought, why not use that Cameo service and ask James Marsters for book recommendations?
Hey, Cece, this is James. Thank you for thinking enough of me to actually ask. What books I would recommend.
By the way, if you enjoy this Cameo service, James Marsters is absolutely reasonably priced, but there's a ton of other celebrities on that service as well. And there's a link down below. If you choose that, I get like a little like referral bonus.
Oh, I like money.
Potentially, if this is going to become a series, maybe I can find another actor. If you go choose that service, choose my link. Thank you.
Yeah, I will.
If you are also a Buffy stan, please let me know who your favorite character is. So if I'm considering making this a series, I know which characters might be interesting. Who is
Spike? His name is William the Bloody. And his nickname by torturing his victims with railroad spikes.
Pretty much the ultimate poser.
Attitude.
He is an extremely observant, kick-ass, empathetic, charismatic character who is completely full of himself and embraces being the big bad.
You are one step away, Missy.
He thinks he's pretty cool, and even though he usually tries to come across as kind of apathetic, he is potentially the person with like who cares the deepest in this show. He has such a huge heart, and he cares and loves so incredibly passionately and deeply and loyally. Ugh.
Love's a funny thing.
Also, Spike has one of the biggest character arcs, going from like doing a complete 180, and if you follow it along, it does make sense to an extent. Yes, there's a few things where like, did that have to happen? But I guess it did. And well, he has the funniest, most kick-ass dialogues.
I don't like to brag. Who am I kidding? I love to brag.
Oh, and he's hot AF.
Kill me.
So we're going to get into 10 aspects of his character and recommend books based on these 10 aspects. Side note, we are not including book recommendations based on like the toxic relationship that is extremely complex and that a lot of people love, simply because I completely refuse to promote books with a toxic relationship.
I'm not putting up with this anymore.
And another note, there might be more layers to Spike, there might be even more character traits. I just had to narrow it down to 10, so let me know if you feel like I missed a major one.
When do we destroy the world already?
One.
We like to talk big. Vampires do. I'm going to destroy the world. It's just tough guy talk.
Spike is an extremely lovable, charismatic villain.
Now that was fun. Oh Don't tell me that wasn't fun. Oh, God. It's been so long since I had a decent spot of violence.
You even really want it? Or is it you just want to take something away from me? Bit of both.
A villain that even ends up befriending the good guys.
Well, I suppose I could be helpful, if the price is right.
What, you think I come running over saying, I've got a secret, beat me till I talk?
And I'm not the first choice for heroics. And Buffy's tried to kill me more than once. And I don't fancy a single one of you at all. But... actually, all that sounds pretty convincing. I wonder if...
Recommend me a book that made you understand, love, or root for the traditionally villain character. Why don't we let James Marsters take this first one?
The best fiction book I've read recently is I Am Pilgrim. Terry Hayes, I want to say, H-A-Y-E-S. But you'll find it. It's a bestseller. Thick book, page burner, about a terrorist who's looking to kill quite a lot of people and the man hunting him. But it takes the side of both. You get behind the eyes of both of the characters, and both of them are human beings, and I ended the book understanding the perspective of both people. Not that I agreed with either one, you know, with one side or the other, but I understood where they were coming from. And but more than anything, it was just a very exciting book. It's one of those books where I could have been on a flight from Australia to the US, which is the longest one that I've ever taken. And still, when the wheels came down, I'd be like, no, I'm almost done with this book. You know, I'm almost done with the chapter. I want to find out what's happening. So it's a really good book.
Two.
And what can I tell you, baby? I've always been bad.
Billions of people walking around like Happy Meals with legs.
In the earlier seasons, Spike tries really, really hard to show that he embraces being evil.
And you're what? Shocked and disappointed? I'm evil.
Even more often than not, he fails at this nowadays.
Cuz I've got things to do. Bad, evil things.
He also does have a history of being a pretty cruel monster.
You know, you take the killing for granted, and then it's gone, and you're like, I wish I'd appreciated it more. Stopped and smelled the corpses, you know?
Recommend a book with an unapologetical evil character. Bonus points if you can find a funny one. For this one, I recommend Wild Seed by Octavia E. Butler. This is Afrofuturism. We have truly evil characters. I don't know how to explain this without going into spoilers, but pretty much Doro is an ancient evil spirit that has cultivated a small village of people in search of perfection. So by cultivated, yes, cultivated, like breeding. We're talking breeding. He steals from their bodies to sustain his own life. So he's like not a shapeshifter. He uses bodies. And Doro pretty much fears no one until he meets a woman. She uses her wisdom to help others, healing injuries, birthing tribes, and shifting the shapes of her own body. So she's like a true shapeshifter. She can shift into whatever she wants. And when you feel no threat until she meets Doro. So these two characters are going to go together against each other. In an epic story of love and hate, Doro and Anyan Wu chase each other across continents and centuries, a power struggle that echoes through generations. Together, they will change the world. 3.
I don't want to be this good-looking and athletic. We all have crosses to bear.
I feel safe with you.
Take that back!
In a nutshell, Spike not only has swagger coming out of his ears.
Who's the puffed up manly man? All splotchy and possessive.
He is a hilariously snarky badass.
If every vampire who said he was at the crucifixion was actually there, it would have been like Woodstock.
With a side of sarcasm.
They were human. Two eyes each, kind of in the middle.
And maybe a hint of delicious banter.
The point is, I work hard for that money.
And you're saying I didn't?
You stole it.
And you're making it into very hard work.
I'm crushing just researching quotes for this one.
I'll show you who's
cool guy. You're going down.
Recommend a book with a snarky, sassy dialogue. For this one, I have The Bad Muslim Discount. I had a couple of books that have snarky, sassy characters, but this is the most recent that I've read. We have a grandma in the beginning who is the best snark, but then overall, the male main character is quite a humoristic person, and I have overly enjoyed this book in general. I do have to read something from a review that I found, because I do think that this should come with a disclaimer. Basically what this book is about is that we have two people from two different countries, I think it was Iraq and Pakistan, that are for different reasons fleeing in the 1990s to San Francisco, and their lives meet and intervene. The woman comes from a war background, like she has experienced war. There's a lot of really serious and really heavy topics in here, so it is not to be underestimated. But I think that the biggest call out that I have to make is for the Muslim representation. And let me just read the review. I want to start by saying that the reason I'm frustrated with this book actually has nothing to do with the characters. In fact, I really enjoyed Anwar's humor and found myself often grinning at his jokes. And that's why the book is here. Neither of them is religious, but that doesn't make the representation invalid. I recognize that not everyone connects to Islam the same way I do. And I respect that. Other struggles felt relatable in a way, and it's understandable that when someone gets abused by a person who claims to be religious, it'll turn them away from that faith. Despite the fact there is a diverse range of Muslim characters in the story, the core of it can be summed up as this. Muslims who practice their religion are potential terrorists, control freaks, abusers, or righteous to the point of harming other people just for the sake of doing the right thing. While Muslims who don't have a strong connection to their faith, who don't practice their religion, don't pray, drink alcohol, and have sex when they want to, those are the only good Muslims. This stereotypical idea of what it means to be Muslim is prevalent in the entire book. So if that is something that you feel like you could potentially feel harmful or that could upset you, please do not read this. Otherwise, do read it. I think it's an amazing book. It has so much potential in terms of the history, where the people are coming from, the harsh things that they have gone through. There's so much really, really good stuff in this book. I absolutely recommend this.
When I say I love you, it's not because I want you, or because I can't have you. It has nothing to do with me. I love what you are.
For someone without a soul, Spike feels very, very, very deeply.
Meaning I have come to redefine the words pain and suffering since I fell in love with you.
She didn't even care enough to cut off my head or set me on fire. I mean, is that too much to ask? You know, some little sign that she cared? She said we could still be friends. God, I'm so unhappy.
And he shows extreme dedication and passion towards the ones that he loves.
Spike, I'm cold.
I got you.
I'm a princess.
That's what you are.
Great love is wild and passionate and dangerous. It burns and consumes.
Recommend a book with a strong, passionate love story. Bonus points if it's not gonna be cheesy. I think one of the best love stories that I've read, aside maybe from Romeo and Juliet, because, oh, tragic, is the love letters of Abelard and Lily. What I really liked about this is that it just showed a love story from a little bit of a different angle. We have two people, one with ADHD and one with Asperger's, and they're both living in their mental health space. They're living with their kind of world, and I feel like it's very, very well represented, and I was able to understand how these two people love and how these two people function as a couple, and it was just so beautiful. Was it the most passionate love story? Probably not, but it wasn't cheesy, and that's what just really appealed to me, and it just felt very, very real. And it gave me a very, very good insight into two mental health problems. problems that I was completely unaware of. Well, I wasn't aware that these mental health problems existed, but I wasn't able to relate to it. I wasn't able to feel what they're feeling, and that book was able to get me there. 5.
The torch I bear is scorching me.
I love you, Cecily.
Please, stop.
I know I'm a bad poet. But I'm a good man. All I ask is that you try to see me.
I do see you. That's the problem. You're nothing to me, William.
Being with you touches me more than I can say. Since I'm only dead to you,
you're beneath me.
Potentially a lot more relatable than I would like.
Love hurts, baby.
The incredibly deep pain that Spike feels.
You hated yourself. And you took it out on me.
Due to the unrequited love story.
Like say I do possessed, want to.
There's a traitor here. Beneath my breast,
it wouldn't be you, Spike.
It hurts me more than you've ever
guessed. Never be
if
you.
My heart could beat, it would break my chest. But I can see you're unimpressed.
So is a predominant part of what makes him so lovable.
I'm nothing without her.
Knowing you're not good enough for the person that you love. Tragic.
I love you.
No, you don't. But thanks for saying it.
Recommend a book that made you cry or really feel deep pain. The Poppy War series, and I just have the third one in the series here as a physical book, is probably the one that made me feel the most pain and shock and in the last like weeks, months, whatever. Well, there's a few others that have shocked me, but this one has made me feel pain on a different level. And this could potentially also double up as if we would have like a slaughtering, massacre, bloody prompt that maybe in a Spike tag we should have at one point, but I decided against it because I felt other things were more important, but this would cover this as well. What I'm really fascinated by is that the Poppy Wars, which is a fantasy story that is based on the Opium Wars in China, is telling war stories with a very, very real perspective, with a very real what happens in war, what happens after war, what happens to people. It doesn't only show the sword fight and doesn't only show killing the emperor or something, it shows what happens to the women who are hiding in a cellar when a city is invaded, kind of thing. And that made me feel pain, made me almost cry, if not cry, and left me devastated. Absolute recommendation, and for like crying pain and bloody shock value, this is the book. 6.
Yeah, leave them to me.
You can't hurt them. What can you do to make sure they're out of the picture?
Not a blessed thing. They're gonna do it for me.
At one point when Spike wasn't able to inflict physical pain because he had a chip in his brain, he started to understand how much havoc he can wreak, the destruction that he can sow by forms of manipulation.
Easier than I thought it'd be, too. Call it the Yoko Factor. Don't tell me you never heard the Beatles. They were once a real powerful group. It's not a stretch to say they rule the world. When they broke up, everyone blamed Yoko. But the fact is, the group split itself apart. She just happened to be there. You know how it is with kids. They go off to college, they grow apart. Way of the world.
Recommend a book with a manipulative character. This could also be like a con artist. A book with a manipulative character is definitely The Living is Easy. The Living is Easy is pretty much a story of a narcissistic character who is making their life in America and is pretty much manipulating their own family to get what they want. The Living is Easy, Dorothy West's first novel and one of only a handful to be published by black women in the 40s, tells the story of Cleo Judson, daughter of Southern sharecroppers, who is obsessively determined to integrate herself and her daughter, Judy, into Boston's black elite. Married to the Black Banana King, Bart Judson, Cleo meanwhile maneuvers her three sisters and their children, but not their husbands, into living with her, attempting to recreate her original family in a newly rented 10-room mansion. Witty, satirical, and razor sharp in its depiction of race and class in early 20th century Boston. We discussed this in the Spilling Tea Book Club, and there were quite a few people who hated this book, or who hated the main character, because the main character is narcissistic and manipulative and is simply not a good person. I do tend to believe that the main character doesn't consider themselves evil, but that they are narcissistic and that they are seriously manipulative, like really no concern for what the other people want, but they think that they're doing them a service. So where Cleo feels like she is doing something good for them, she's pretty much destroying their life, but she thinks it's better for them. Wow, this is just, I love this so much, because this was a villain evil story without being marketed and without being like, oh, look here, villain backstory. What made this book even more intriguing is that it sounded like the author potentially was writing about their mother. Wow. Seven.
I know you haven't been in the game for a while, mate, but we still do kill people. Sort of our raison d'etre, you know.
God, he's gonna kill her.
Spike embraces being evil.
Oh, you say the word and she's a footnote in history. I'll make it look like a painful accident.
Yeah, I could do that, but I'm paralyzed with not caring very much.
He considers himself the big bad.
You'd better be more than sure, mate. Because I'd hate to have to hurt you.
If at first you don't succeed, I'll kill him, and you try again.
A rebel and a punk rocker.
No, I'm a rebel. You're an idiot.
I was gonna nick it, because that's what I do. I go where I please and I take what I want. And what's your excuse?
Recommend a book with a truly morally gray character or like an evil vampire. In this world, vampires do not sparkle. Bonus points if you can find a character with a swagger attitude. For this one, I am recommending The Secret Life of Laszlo Count Dracula. I read this in my 20s when I was on the big, oh my God, I love vampires hype. And I love this book so, so much, but I haven't read it in 20 years. So forgive me if it doesn't hold up because I can't find my copy. Potentially I have given it to somebody to read because I'm so convinced of this book. But I still feel like this absolutely fit. In this mesmerizing fictional debut, psychiatrist Roderick Anscombe creates a stunning reinvention of the classic Dracula myth. In a sweeping prose, this epic delves into the fevered mind of a man living two lives, a public healer and a private monster whose tormented psyche draws him into a world of violent emotion, bloodlust, and self-loathing. I remember that I devoured this and I loved it because it had all these parts. It had the struggle and the psychologic struggle and the bloodlust and everything. Eight.
Bugger. You're fixing to do something stupid, aren't you?
One of my personal favorite character angles is that Spike's job is pretty much to confront the hero.
No, see, you're not getting it, Mr. Bits. You're gonna be interestingly dead.
And tells them that they are—
Are you brain dead?
Or what they are about to do is freaking stupid.
We're making a tear in the galaxy or whatnot? You think you're just gonna sew that back up?
Is everyone here very stoned?
Recommend a book with a really great anti-hero or a snarky main character. Yes, we already did snarky, but as this is based on Spike, we can sew a double snark. For this one, I recommend the End I Darken series. The End I Darken series is based on the history of what the Dracula story is based on, but with flipped genders. So we have a Count Dracula, a royal Dracula person who is a feral, savage female, but it's more like historical fiction and not fantasy. We don't have vampires. It's more based on like the historical facts that the tale of Dracula is based on. And that with gender flipped roles. This book was so good. This series was so amazing. I loved the LGBTQ representation and how it was historically woven in, that it kind of worked and it didn't feel funny or weird or placed inaccurately, but it was handled so beautifully. I loved the Dracula, our main character, the Dracula character, and she's just savage. And at the same time, you understand, or potentially most people, hopefully, and it's not just me being weird and evil, understand where she's coming from. She is an evil character still, and she is driven by things that you could potentially consider as evil, but she's still just a person, and she has motivation that is understandable. She's so layered, and I also loved that, I think especially the second book in the series gave me some historical context that I wasn't fully aware of, and I felt like I had some history lessons without having opening a history book and without feeling like I was reading history. It was so amazingly done. So after this, I went and wanted to read everything that Kirsten White wrote, who, by the way, wrote Slayer, a new, like, book in the Buffyverse, if you weren't aware. 9.
What, are you people blind? She's hanging on by a thread. And a ninny could see that.
As tough as Spike is, he is so extremely observant. Potentially the most observant character in the whole freaking show.
You're lying.
Like, he knows what people are feeling, what they're experiencing. He just is potentially the biggest empath. Shocking, I know. He sums up historical things pretty much perfectly. The truth just does not get past him. Especially when Angel and Buffy do the whole, "Oh, we're just friends" spiel.
You're not friends. You'll never be friends. You'll be in love till it kills you both. You'll fight. And you'll shag, and you'll hate each other till it makes you quiver, but you'll never be friends. Love isn't brains, children. It's blood. Blood screaming inside you to work its will. I may be love's bitch, but at least I'm man enough to admit it.
Recommend a book that has made you change your perspective on the world or on something, or that just made you more observant in general. For this one, I can totally recommend the whole Wayfarer series. This is, I believe, the 4th one, but every single book in the Wayfarer series does cover this. The Wayfarer series is a science fiction book that kind of reminds me of the Star Trek experience. We have different seasons that play in different areas. It's still somehow connected within the world, but we have completely different characters in all 3 books. Maybe one character like swaps over or is mentioned or something, but it's not the same cast for all books. It's also not the same location. I think in the first book we're on a ship on a mission. On the second, we're on a planet in like very isolated areas, and there's a whole focus on AI and robotics. In the third one, we are on a space station. The fourth one, we are on a planet again. We have a lot of different species. We have a lot of different types of people. These story arcs are just, there's like a minor story going in the background. And yes, there is like the typical story arc that you want, but I think that if you read it for the story, you will probably be disappointed, because it's a very simple story. The main thing why you should read this is the dialogues, is the conversations between these characters. This is so deep, so rich. I feel like every chapter brings up a new topic that they discuss, and it just challenges our view of the world. It challenges us to think above and beyond our biological restrictions in our mind. It challenges our worldview and it kind of makes us more tolerant and open to others, because it just questions, like a conversation between two species questioning each other and their habits makes you question why we assume the things that we assume. And for this is so, so, so freaking good. I love this series so much. if you haven't read it, even if you don't like science fiction, I think that you can get a lot out of it. 10.
Because every time you look at me, you see all the dirty little things I've done. All the lives I've taken because of you. Drusilla sired me. But you made me a monster. I didn't make you, Spike. I just opened up the door and let the real you out. You never knew the real me.
Spike's character arc might be the most complex with the most extreme growth that somehow made sense to me personally that I have come across in my life.
Always got to be blood. Blood is life, like brain. Why do you think we eat it? So it keeps you going, makes you warm, makes you hard, makes you other than dead.
He also made so many amazing life lesson statements throughout the show.
Life's not a song. Life isn't bliss. Life is just this. It's living. You'll get along. The pain that you feel, you only can heal by living. You have to go on living. So one of us is living.
Recommend a book that helped you grow. To close this tag off, let us hear from James again, shall we?
I think the best nonfiction book I've read in many years is called A Purpose-Guided Universe by Bernard Haisch, H-A-I-S-C-H. He is an astrophysicist out of the University of Arizona, and he wrote a book arguing on the basis of science that the universe was created by an intelligent, creative force. He does not argue on faith. He argues on science, and it's very compelling. He said that the chances, scientifically speaking, the chances that this universe is specifically designed by an intelligent force is very high. The chances that has anything to do with earthly religion, scientifically speaking, is very low. I think about this book all the time. It's not a long book. There was a few chapters I had to read a couple of times, but I'm not a scientist, and I found it digestible, and I recommend it to a lot of people. I think it's wonderful.
Bonus! If you don't know the character Spike, you can totally leave this bonus off, but if you do, what do you think Spike would read?
Interesting question about what Spike would recommend. I mean, maybe Spike now, after having had a soul for 20 years, would be a very different Spike than the one that we left at the end of Angel, who only had a soul for maybe a year or two. Because I think that he was in the process of growing up, basically. So 20 years down the line, he might be ever trying to increase his peace of mind, I guess. And so I would say that maybe Spike would recommend this book, No Death, No Fear. There's the author, who is a Vietnamese monk. It's basically Buddhism for dummies. but I have found it to be very enlightening. At first, completely confusing, like, I'm not getting any of this. I don't understand any of it. But as I've gone through the book, I understand more and more. And I've started meditating since I read this. I'm in the middle of it, as you can see, my huge bookmark here. So yeah, maybe that would be, you know, it's kind of a surprising choice. But I do think that Spike, one of the things that I'm, one of the moments in Buffy that I like so much, my favorite moment is that when Buffy says, I love you, and he says, no, you don't, but thanks for saying it. Because I think that's a moment of being self-aware for Spike, and he understands in that moment that he's not good enough for Buffy yet. That he's got a lot of growing up to do before he's the kind of creature that would deserve someone like Buffy. and could be healthy for her. And he fully intends to go out into the world and learn his lessons and get his scrapes and bumps and figure out what to do with this soul. And once he does that, I fully thought that he would come back and be with Buffy. And the comic books kind of have that happening. So, you know, 20 years down the line, I think they're probably still together and he's probably reading this book.
So this is it for the tag.
That was fun.
I hope that you enjoyed this. I hope that you want to do this tag now.
Yeah, I bet you do.
If you see this, consider yourself tagged. If you're doing this, please make sure that you either link this to me or that you tag me somehow on social media so that I'm aware of you doing this, because I just want to see each and every one that has been done if anybody chooses to do this. The people that I really want to see the recommendations from are Completely Melanie, Eric from Breaks Even Books, Amy Myers, Steph Mo from Paperback Mo, Noel from Noel 7 Pages, and Connor from Connor's Library Corner. If I haven't mentioned you, I still want to see you do this tag, and there's a couple of people that I hope that are doing it. Specifically chose these people because of their reading taste, and I'm really curious as to what they would pick for these prompts based on their reading taste. That's pretty much why I tagged them. But if you see this, consider yourself tagged. Let's get on to seeing which tags I have been tagged on in the last couple of months and start responding. See you.
Well, not exactly the St. Crispin's Day speech, was it?
Just loving this moment. Can we stay here forever? I'm loving this moment. Can we stay here together? If I could stop the